Hello, I'm Dhruv Singhal, Solutions Architect Manager based out of India. I joined Amazon 2 years back and have been in the IT industry for over 28 years. This is a level 200 session. Therefore, some familiarity with AWS constructs has been assumed. In the next 30 odd minutes, I will be talking about how organizations worldwide are adopting hybrid IT infrastructure to maximize returns on the existing on-premise investment, as well as becoming more nimble and agile by using the cloud. The major milestones in our journey today will include establishing connectivity between your on-premise infrastructure and the AWS cloud. We will also cover how you will integrate and manage users, groups, servers, and other resources across the two environments. We will see how you can get a single consolidated view of all your resources, no matter whether they're on-premise or on the cloud. Finally, we will look at some of the common workloads which have been moved to the cloud. So, what do we mean by hybrid infrastructure? It is an environment where your resources are located both on-premise and on the cloud. In this environment, a user could log on to a server on the cloud, but the authentication would be done against a directory service which is located on premises. This is obviously a new way of designing solutions, and the question then arises is, why are we doing this? The reasons are manifold, the primary one being growth and in some cases survival. The existing industry models are being disrupted by startups which are using the cloud very effectively to take market share away from the incumbents. Airbnb and Spotify are two companies which have disrupted the hotel and music industries. Established enterprises need a way to leverage the cloud to become more nimble and agile to meet these challenges. But they cannot go from being 100% on-premise to 100% cloud in one go. You have investments in your own data center that you want to continue to take advantage of. You could have workloads which are based on proprietary hardware and cannot be moved to the cloud. You need a mechanism by which you can leverage your existing on-premise resources as well as take advantage of what the cloud has to offer. This is where hybrid infrastructure comes in. Over the past few years, AWS has been making large investments to make hybrid architectures easier to deploy and your journey to the cloud as smooth as possible. Some of the areas where we are focused are around connectivity and managing access to users and groups across the two environments. We've also developed plugins for your existing on-premise management tools, thereby letting you use a familiar interface to manage resources on the AWS cloud. Finally, we have developed tools and utilities which can let you import and export your virtual machines to the AWS cloud. We now come to the first major milestone in our journey, connectivity between the on-premises data center and AWS cloud. We need to first define what we want to connect to. In our case, it is the Amazon Virtual Private Cloud, or VPC for short. The VPC allows you to provision a logically isolated section of the AWS cloud where you can define your own network address space. You can define your own subnets with the desired IP address ranges, routing tables, and network gateways for both private and internet connectivity. You can configure security groups to control the traffic which flows into and out of the VPC. Very similar to the functionality provided by firewalls in an on-premise environment. For example, within a VPC, you can launch an EC2 instance which gets an IP address within your VPC range. You can deploy these instances across multiple availability zones to increase the resilience of your systems. You can create a public-facing subnet for your web servers that have access to the internet, or you can create a private-facing subnet which has no access to the internet and place your backend systems, such as databases and application servers, in this subnet. We provide you with a range of security features to configure NACLs and stateful firewall rules known as security groups. These features allow you to build a security profile for your VPC, usually more secure than a traditional data center. We have multiple connectivity options which you can use to connect to the AWS cloud. When you start off, you're most likely to connect to the VPC over the public internet. Please note that even though you're connecting over the internet, you will control access to the VPC by using security groups. You can create a public subnet with an EC2 instance providing the functionality of a Bastion host. All access to the VPC would occur via the Bastion host. The security group setting on the Bastion host will ensure that only servers from your data center can access it. In the normal course, you will very quickly graduate to an IPsec VP connection between your on-premises IT and the AWS cloud. All traffic to and from instances in your VPC can be routed to your corporate data center over an industry standard encrypted IPsec hardware VPN connection. For configuring a VPN, you will need to attach a virtual gateway to your VPC, and this virtual gateway will act as the terminating point for the VPN connection you originated from your data center. You can use a wide range of hardware VPN devices. From a routing perspective, you can use static routing, or you can use BGP protocol if you want a dynamically routed VPN connection. We get asked this question very often: what happens if the VPN connection dies? The Amazon Virtual Private Gateway uses two parallel IPsec tunnels to ensure constant connectivity. The BGP protocol will dynamically route traffic to the live IPsec tunnel to ensure there's no loss of connectivity. At AWS, we believe in providing all possible constructs which help in improving the resiliency of the infrastructure. The subnets behind the VPN gateway are propagated via BGP, thereby allowing you to access the servers running inside the VPC. Direct Connect. Using Direct Connect, you get a dedicated connection between your on-premises data center and AWS. This means that you're not contending for bandwidth with other applications on the internet. It also helps to ensure consistent latency. Companies also use Direct Connect for compliance and regulatory reasons. Our Direct Connect service provides 1 gigabit and 10 gigabit connectivity. For bandwidth requirements lower than 1 GB, you can work with one of our APN partners. You can, of course, get bandwidth of more than 10 GB by setting up multiple connections of 1 GB or 10 GB. Connecting to multiple VPCs over Direct Connect. This diagram shows 4 common workload scenarios with Direct Connect. The first box shows how you can isolate the public-facing applications without connecting them to a data center. This will ensure that public users cannot get access to your data center. The second box shows how you can extend public-facing applications to integrate with backend services like database and application infrastructure. The third box shows how you can have applications running on AWS resources that are only accessible from your on-premises infrastructure. In this case, public users have no way to access the VPC. Lastly, many enterprises use Direct Connect to extend common core services like AD or core repositories into AWS. These common services are used by the applications running in the other VPCs. Like I mentioned before, AWS has made substantial investments to help organizations in reducing the effort required to integrate the AWS cloud with your existing infrastructure. For example, Amazon gives you the ability to import your existing VMs into AWS. You can import VMware VMs, Hyper-V window VMs, or VMs which use Citrix Xen virtualization formats directly into AWS. This helps in substantially reducing the effort required to migrate your applications to the AWS cloud. In addition, we now have a plugin for EC2 within Microsoft System Center Virtual Machine Manager. This allows you to manage your on-premise VMs as well as your Amazon EC2 instances running Windows or Linux from within your Microsoft System Center. This means you have a single pane of glass to all your resources, regardless of whether they are located on-premise or on the cloud. Our other partners like BMC and CA also provide similar tools which allow you to have a consolidated view of your entire IT landscape. We will be focusing on three main aspects of enterprise integration: authentication access control, federation, and operations monitoring. In this part of the journey, we will talk about how this can be enabled on AWS. AWS Directory Service is a managed service offering providing directories that contain information about your organization, including users, groups, computers, and other resources. These directories could be physically located on the AWS cloud, or it could be a proxy pointing to your on-premises Microsoft Active Directory. As it is a managed offering, AWS Directory Service is designed to reduce management and administrative burden, thereby allowing you to focus more of your time and resources on your business. There's no need to build out your own complex, highly available directory topology, because each directory is deployed across multiple AZs, and monitoring automatically detects and replaces domain controllers that fail. In addition, data replication and automated daily snapshots are configured for you. There is no software to install, and AWS handles all of the patching and software updates. Once your directory is created, you can use it to manage users and groups, provide single sign-on to applications, create and apply group policy, domain join Amazon EC2 instances, as well as simplify the deployment and management of cloud-based Linux and Microsoft Windows workloads. The best part is that users do not need to create one more set of user IDs and passwords to access services on the AWS cloud. The users can continue to use the existing corporate credentials when accessing AWS applications, such as Amazon Workspaces, Amazon WorkDocs, and Amazon Workmail, as well as directory-aware Microsoft workloads, including SharePoint, custom.net, and SQL Server-based applications. You can choose from three different directory types, including AD Connector, Simple AD, and AWS Directory Service for Microsoft Active Directory, also known as Microsoft AD. AD Connector. AD Connector is a directory gateway that allows you to proxy directory requests to your on-premises Microsoft AD without caching any information in the cloud. The advantage of the AD Connector is that you do not have to manage users across the two environments. No issues of replication or synchronization. The disadvantage is the increased latency, as the authentication and authorization requests have to be routed to the on-premises AD. The AD Connector uses either a secure VPN or Direct Connect to talk to your on-premises Active Directory. Simple AD. A Simple AD is a managed directory powered by a SAMBA 4 Active Directory compatible server. It provides a subset of the functionality offered by Microsoft AD. In this case, the user and group information is stored on the AWS cloud. The third type of directory type supported by AWS Directory Services is a fully managed Microsoft Active Directory deployment on the AWS cloud. It is highly available as it is deployed across two availability zones. You can use this directory to authenticate users who are using Microsoft Exchange, SharePoint, SQL Server, and .NET applications on the AWS cloud. The directory also supports external trust relationships with existing Active Directory domains. This means that you can establish a trust relationship between the AD domains running on-premise and on the cloud. You do not need to learn new management tools. You can continue to use your familiar management tooling for administration. In a dynamic environment like AWS, EC2 instances are constantly being created and shut down. Having a managed AD on the AWS cloud allows for Windows instances to seamlessly join the domain on launch. This substantially eases the effort of managing the EC2 instances. It also supports federation and single sign-on to AWS console without having to use Active Directory federation services. This allows your users to seamlessly gain access to AWS services. There is another way in which you can give secure access to AWS to your end users. This is via Identity Federation. The end user makes a request to a federation proxy for the AWS session. The federation proxy is an application which you have to develop. The federation proxy first verifies the user against the on-premises directory and also gets the user entitlements. It uses a set of IAM user credentials to make a GET Federation token request to AWS Secure Token Service, STS. The AWS STS then responds with AWS credentials, which can be used by the user to call AWS APIs to get access to AWS resources such as S3, DynamoDB, or EC2. If you do not want to build your own Federation proxy application, there is an easier way. You can also federate to AWS using industry standard SAML 2.0 integration. It's supported by many common on-premise directories, as well as a range of other external SAML 2.0 compliant IT providers. Now that you have enabled authorized access to AWS services for your end users, you also need a mechanism by which you can manage and monitor the usage. You probably already have a well-established system which you use for security information and event management, SIEM in short. The requirement is to extend this functionality to the AWS cloud. We will now look at some of the AWS services which can be used to provide this functionality. We will start with CloudTrail, which is probably the most important service from an SIEM perspective. It can log all events from IAM, our Identity and Access Management Service, and most other AWS services. The logs generated by CloudTrail can be sent to an on-premises SIEM aggregator where they can be processed. You can therefore have a consistent set of policies to apply to your on-premise infrastructure as well as to your resources on the AWS cloud. The CloudTrail logs are essential from an auditing perspective and when you need to manage a security event. For monitoring applications running on EC2 instances, you will require a log agent to be installed and configured. The logs generated by this agent will be sent to the SIEM aggregator. CloudWatch logs is an extension of the CloudWatch monitoring facility and provides the ability to pass system, service, and application logs in near real time. There is a filtering syntax that it can be used to trigger SNS alerts in the event of certain conditions. At AWS, we are constantly looking for customer feedback. One of the long-standing feature requests from the security committee has been a service which can be used to monitor the traffic flowing through the VPC. The VPC flow log service has been provided to meet this request. A key part of a SIEM solution is the ability to process firewall logs as it is very useful to know which requests are getting rejected and who is trying to access protected resources. VPC flow logs now gives you a much clearer view of the traffic within your VPC. Also, flow logs data is processed by CloudWatch logs and can be analyzed along with other data. Config is a service that allows you to track and compare infrastructure changes in your environment over time and restore them if necessary. It provides a full inventory of your AWS resources and the facility to snapshot it into CloudFormation templates in S3. It also integrates with CloudTrail and CloudWatch logs to provide a very useful SIM function. For example, if a new security group gets created with an open access rule from the internet, an alert can be raised. We will now look at how you can integrate AWS into your operations. CloudWatch and CloudWatch logs are the primary services which you will use to get insight into the behavior and performance of the AWS services. For each AWS service, CloudWatch provides metrics which can be used to monitor that service. In addition, you can define your own business metrics and publish them to CloudWatch. We also provide functionality to build your own custom dashboards using CloudWatch metrics. You can set up alerts as CloudWatch alarms, which in turn can trigger Amazon Simple Notification Service, or SNS for short. The SNS service can then send the alert as a SMS or email. You can also build your own custom alerts using Lambda on top of SNS. You also have the option of having your own monitoring agents running on the EC2 instances. These agents will send the desired information to the monitoring server. The monitoring server could be located on the AWS cloud or could be on premises. Many of your existing tools already have integration with the AWS APIs. These include a number of open source tools and commercial offerings like Microsoft System Center. With Microsoft System Center, you can monitor and manage your Windows infrastructure on AWS as you do today. Our open API architecture allows third-party vendors to easily integrate with AWS. Management tool vendors like CA and BMC have extended their monitoring functionality to include AWS services. And remember, your established operation processes don't need to change. You simply have the opportunity to make them more agile and adapt them to the functionality that the AWS platform offers. Let us now look at some of the common workloads in a hybrid environment. Most organizations start off by moving their dev and test workloads to the AWS cloud. There's an easy way to get hands-on experience with the cloud. It helps to accelerate application development, as you can use AWS services like CodeCommit for source repository, CodePipeline for building your executables, and CodeDeploy for deploying your applications on the EC2 instance. CloudFormation templates can be used to create new environments in minutes, allowing your developers to focus on application development. This also helps in increasing developer productivity because they no longer have to wait for the hardware to arrive, operating system and databases installed and configured, and other operational activities. Also, once the development activity is complete, they can shut down these environments, thereby saving money and reducing total cost of ownership. You can also do a mix and match, wherein you can use your on-premise code repository, but then build and deployment happen on the AWS cloud. The ability to spin up large number of EC2 instances in a few minutes means that you can test your applications at scale, thereby identifying and resolving scalability issues early on in the development cycle. You can also use the AWS infrastructure to do POCs, using AWS Marketplace to try and test software from different ISV vendors. Another popular use case on the AWS cloud is backup and archive. AWS provides multiple services which can help your organization in creating a cost-efficient backup solution. Also, AWS import-export can be used to ship this to AWS for backing up terabytes or even petabytes of data. This service is typically used for one-time transfer. The Snowball is a data appliance from AWS which can transfer up to 80 terabytes in one go. That's a lot of data. AWS Storage Gateway can be used to transfer data on a continuous basis to the AWS cloud. Data which you traditionally stored on tapes can be transferred easily to the AWS cloud by using the Gateway Virtual Tape Library offering from AWS. The virtual interface it provides lets you leverage your existing tape backup infrastructure to store data on virtual tape cartridges. The data, of course, is stored in the AWS cloud, and you don't need to provision for extra storage on premises. Each virtual gateway can store up to 1 petabyte of data. You can have multiple virtual gateways to store multiple petabytes of data. You can also use solutions from partners like NetApp and Veritas to back up data from on-premises to AWS cloud. The data on the AWS cloud can be stored on S3, a simple storage service. S3 has been designed for 11 nines of durability. You therefore do not have to worry about the durability of your data on the cloud. A natural extension of backup and archive is disaster recovery. You have already backed up your data to the cloud. You can start up the desired compute resources to have a replica of your on-premises production environment on the cloud. You can use AWS services to quickly scale up your DR infrastructure in the event of a disaster at your primary DC. This allows you to significantly bring down the cost of your DR site, as you are only paying for the resources you use. The data migration service offering from Amazon greatly reduces the effort required in keeping your cloud databases in sync with your on-premises databases. In this case, the transaction logs are shipped in a continuous manner from your on-premises database and rerun on your databases running on the AWS cloud. This means that at any time, your cloud database is only a few minutes behind your on-premises database. You can also leverage the big data capabilities of the AWS cloud. You can ship your log data to AWS cloud and run Hadoop clusters with hundreds or thousands of servers to do log analytics in a fraction of the time it took to run them on-premise. Elastic MapReduce, EMR, service from AWS provides a managed Hadoop framework which you can use to quickly start up and shut down Hadoop clusters. Using EMR allows you to leverage the power of the Hadoop ecosystem without having to learn the nitty-gritty of managing Hadoop clusters. Similarly, you can ship your production data to AWS cloud and use Redshift as your data warehousing engine. Redshift is a petabyte-scale data warehouse offering from AWS. AWS's pay-as-you-go model ensures that you're only paying for the resources you are using. Lastly, customers are also moving their business-critical applications, like the ERP production systems, onto the AWS cloud. The ability to scale up and down on demand means that your mission-critical applications will never run short of resources. The ability to encrypt data in transit and at rest means that your data is secure at all times. Customers are moving their critical workloads to AWS because they find that their security posture actually improves when they move their applications to the AWS cloud. Today, some of the customers are implementing an all-in strategy wherein they want to shut down all the data centers and move all the applications to the cloud. Summarizing, the key points I have covered in my session: connectivity is normally the first step and a key to a successful integration between the cloud and your corporate data center. Managing users across the on-premise and cloud environments is a key to ensuring secure access. Hybrid infrastructure allows you to continue using your existing on-premise resources while gaining from the agility and cost advantage which the cloud offers. To gain more confidence and hands-on experience with AWS, watch our instructional videos and explore the self-paced labs. You can also attend our instructor-led classes by qualified AWS instructors and learn how to design, deploy, and operate highly available and cost-effective and secure applications on AWS. Validate your technical expertise with AWS and use practice exams to help you prepare for AWS certification. Get more info at http://aws.amazon.com/training. Thank you for attending the session. We hope you find it interesting. Do provide us with your feedback and let us know how we can improve the event experience for you in the future.